بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
In the name of Allah, the Most Gracious, the Most Merciful.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. In the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, most beneficent, most merciful. Alhamdulillah, all praise is indeed due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillahi wa ala alihi wa ashabihi wa man walaha. Complete blessings and salutations be upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his entire household, all his companions. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless them all and to bless every single one of us. Ameen. Honorable dignitaries, brothers and sisters in Islam, indeed, we always hear the term Rahmatun lil Alameen, mercy to the worlds. We hear it referring to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam based on the verse of Surah Al-Anbiya, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. And we have not sent you except as رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. So what does it mean? If you take a look at the term rahma, it refers to mercy. Mercy is of so many types. Mentioned in the Quran right at the beginning, if you were to look at Surah Al-Fatiha, the opening surah or chapter of the Quran that we repeat so many times during the day in the daily prayers, you would find a tremendous verse, a beautiful, powerful verse. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, having opened the verses of the Quran with the term or with the verse Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, all praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then he describes himself. Who is Allah? So you have sometimes the non-Muslims and even the Muslims asking a question, who do you worship? Allah. What is Allah or who is Allah? It's a question they ask. Some people think Allah is a man. Some people think he is a black box in Mecca. Some people think he is an idol, the one that remained when all the idols were destroyed, as rumor has it that there was one that was remaining. This is all propaganda against the Muslimin and Islam. But if you were to look at who exactly it is, Allah describes him and describes who is Allah immediately after saying, Alhamdulillah, all praise is due to Allah. The question might arise, who is this Allah? So he says, Rabbil Alameen. He is the one who is Rabb of the worlds. Al Alameen here referring to entire creation from the beginning to the end. So what is the meaning of Rabb? Rabb is an Arabic term made up of three letters, Ra, Ba, and Ba. So there is a Ra and there are two Ba's. It means the one who created, nourishes, cherishes, sustains, provides, protects, cures. The one in absolute control of every aspect of existence is known as Rabbun. So if you say, I worship Allah, all it means is, I worship He who made me, He who created me in the first place, who nourishes, cherishes, sustains, provides me, who cures me, who grants me every form of goodness, who is in control of my happiness, my sadness, the one who is in control of absolutely everything regarding every single creature. He is the one I worship. When I put my head on the ground, I say, Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. I am declaring the praise of Allah, the glorification of Allah, who is the one who made me. I am declaring the praise of He who made me. And I'm on the ground. My head is on the ground. I say, O you who made me. Nobody can deny the correctness of that statement. O you who made me, you are the highest. And where is my head? It is at the moment on the lowest position possible. For whom? For you who made me alone. You are not allowed to do sajda, prostration, sujood to anyone but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who is that Allah? Who made you? He made you. You love yourself, don't you? Well, to be honest, you need to love the one who made you because he made you the way you are. Subhanallah. So this is why he says, all praise is due to Allah, the one who created everything. Praise is due to him. And immediately after that, he says, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, describing himself, continuing to describe himself. He started off by saying, all praise is due to Allah. The first description, he said, Rabbil Alameen, the one who is the creator, nourisher, cherisher, sustainer, as we said, of entire creation. Then he said, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Most merciful, most merciful. Some translate it as most beneficent, most merciful. Some say most merciful, a common mercy, and most merciful, a specialized mercy. And I'll explain what that means. The difference between Rahman and Rahim, they are both drawn from the same root of Rahma, Rahama. They are both drawn from the same root. But Rahman is referring to the common mercy of all the creatures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is merciful upon the disbelievers. He is merciful upon the believers. He is merciful upon the animals. He is merciful upon all the animals, those that we are allowed to consume and those we are not allowed to consume. He is merciful upon the plants, upon absolutely everything. That is the mercy, Ar-Rahman. He is the one who is absolutely merciful. If he wanted, he could have started off by warning us. He could have said, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. And then he could have said, the one who punishes and his punishment is severe. He could have said that. But to be honest, his mercy dictates that he will forgive absolutely everything for as long as we seek his forgiveness. No matter what you've done, you seek his forgiveness, him alone. In Islam, we do not confess our sin to anyone. Nobody needs to know what you have done in terms of sin. Not your husband, not your wife, to start off with. Not your mother or father, or child or brother or sister. Not a priest, not a mufti, not a sheikh, not a grand mufti. No one needs to know. It's between you and Allah. The minute you conform to four conditions, you will be forgiven. What are these four conditions? You admit your error. You admit that it was wrong what I did. You regret it. Oh, I feel remorse. You ask Allah's forgiveness. Oh, you who made me. Oh, you whom I'm going to return to. You know that I admitted my sin. I regret it. I ask you to forgive me. Third condition. The fourth condition is, promise not to do it again. I promise you I won't do it again. And Allah says, the minute these four conditions have been met, your sin is wiped out. Do not allow the devil to make you doubt the fact that you've been forgiven. This is mercy. This is the mercy that Islam is based upon. People say that Christianity is based on mercy. Jesus died for your sins, and he was, or should I say, according to the Christian belief, they say that the Almighty happened to literally kill off his only son. Astaghfirullah. Obviously we don't believe this. In order that everyone else may be redeemed. So they say, for the sins of others. Jesus died for our sins. Have you heard that before? We say, Allah is merciful. Rahmatun lil alameen. Allah's mercy dictates that he does not need to kill before he forgives. He does not need to destroy and spill blood before he forgives. You seek forgiveness directly to him and you are forgiven. You do not take a risk in your worship. So we do not worship Jesus, may peace be upon him. We do not worship Moses, may peace be upon him. We do not worship Muhammad, may peace be upon him. We worship no creature. We only worship he who created entire creation. That is why Islam is the fastest growing religion on earth. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us purify our acts of worship so that we render them for none other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah says, I am the owner of mercy. I am the one who has mercy on everything. Today, we look at the non-Muslims. We don't want to greet them. We want to frown at them. Why? These are not yet Muslims. These are your brothers and sisters in humanity. Perhaps you may be related to them. In fact, you are related to them. I am related to every single one of you seated here or listening to this lecture now, or those who will listen to it later. Aren't we all from Adam? And aren't we all from Noah? Nuh, may peace be upon them all. We are children of the same fathers and mothers. We should learn to love one another, to greet one another, to smile at one another, to fulfill one another's rights. Imagine a sunnah, part of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He dictates that through the sunnah and the tradition and the method and the style of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we should be smiling. People say, oh wow, it's so good to smile. Yes, you smile. I tell you something. The smile alleviates suffering, number one. Number two, it lets out or it beams a very positive vibe that comes from you. Something so positive. Imagine if we were all smiling. You go to work, the only people smiling are the Muslimin. Everyone else looks at them and says, wow, I wonder what they are following. We are all depressed in the tension of the world, and here are these people smiling. It makes them feel good, number one. Number two is, they want to know, what is it that makes you smile? Even though you have stress, even though you may have lost a person in your family, even though you may have been diagnosed with a disease, may Allah grant cure to all those who are suffering in any way. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all, my brothers and sisters. Imagine just a smile. The mercy in a smile is such that the next person feels it. It is contagious. When you smile, against all odds, those who are going through some form of suffering would only but want to smile with you. They will be wondering, what is it? What is it? And when they come to realize that we believe in something known as qada wal qadar, ar-rida bil qada, we are happy with the decree and the decision of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If Allah has inflicted you or affected you with something that you had no role to play in, you need to immediately understand, I am happy with this. I am still smiling. What do we say when a relative passes away, when someone passes away, when something bad happens? Do you know what we are taught?
الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ قَالُوا إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ.
Those whom, when some form of calamity or hardship or difficulty affects them, they immediately say, indeed, we all belong to Allah. And unto Allah is our ultimate return. All this pain and all the suffering is absolutely limited. It will not last forever. It is a day for you and a day against you. That is how the world works. But the mercy of Allah dictates that when you have strong faith in Allah, it keeps you going. Imagine those who don't believe in Allah. What keeps them going? Nothing. They are depressed. They become so materialistic. They worship money. Everything is money. You are happy when you have money. You are sad when you do not have money. Evidence to prove that this is completely wrong is that there are so many from amongst us who have more money than all of us put together, yet they cannot sleep. Yet they cannot walk. They cannot eat. They cannot talk. So many things going wrong in their lives. They have disaster in their marriages, in their children. This goes to show happiness is not connected to materialism. I know of people in Africa who live under a tree, but they snore and sleep and perhaps have better dreams than those who are multi-millionaires sleeping in bungalows and in five-star hotels. Subhanallah. So it's got nothing to do with that. Allah says, we will test you, each one of you. Some we will give you more and others we will give you less. But it's a test for those who have more to see how they react and how they become. It's a test for those who have less to see how they react and how they become. Do they have mercy in their hearts? This is the mercy we are speaking about tonight. When Allah says, we are merciful upon all. I made mention moments ago that some of us have a stigma. We look at the non-Muslim and we think that this non-Muslim or not yet Muslim is actually a person who does not deserve to be counted as a human being. They are not enemies, not at all. They are human beings. So many from amongst us perhaps have reverted to Islam. Where were we before? Can I have the liberty to say every single one of us is a revert to Islam? Can I prove it to you? Where were you 5 generations back, were all your forefathers Muslim? No, they were not. They entered the fold of Islam. If they were treated the way we treat those who are not yet Muslim today, what would have happened to our forefathers? They would have never entered the fold of Islam. So wake up and smell the coffee. The problem is in Malaysia, they don't have coffee, they have teh tarik. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. Trust me, it tastes so beautiful. As soon as I came here, they told me, what will you drink? I said, teh tarik. Beautiful, alhamdulillah. A little bit too sweet sometimes. But I think that's where you guys get all your sweetness from. You know, after you have a cup of teh tarik, even your accent changes. You become, mashallah, boleh, alhamdulillah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease. So my brothers and sisters, the mercy of Allah is such that it encompasses everything. Have a little bit of mercy as well. Mercy towards absolutely all those who are around you, including the animals. Imagine, we are not allowed to harm animals. We are only allowed to take the life away of an animal when it is absolutely needed. And for this reason, to go on a hunting spree just to kill animals is actually not Islamic at all. People who go out and murder Cecil and the likes in Zimbabwe, where I come from, that is not an Islamic teaching at all. Islam says, do not kill animals unless you really have to. And when you really have to, for consumption purposes or for some other legitimate purpose, such as perhaps some of the skins and the hides, and perhaps maybe sometimes in order to protect yourself from harm and danger. For example, I'm not allowed to just go into the forest and start killing all the lions. But if a lion is attacking, I'm allowed to protect myself perhaps by taking the life of the lion away. You know, I don't start making friends with the lion and say, no, I'm merciful, mashallah, I'm merciful. The lion doesn't know that language, subhanallah. But we ask Allah to grant us goodness and ease. The beauty is, we are taught to be kind to animals so much so that even if you are taking the life of that animal away for consumption, the hadith says, be merciful. Let it be a quick, clean swipe with a sharp blade such that the least suffering is inflicted upon that particular animal. That is Islam. This is when it will be considered halal. Allah gave the life of that chicken to the chicken. Who are you to take the life away? Who are you? Nobody. You have no permission to take the life of a chicken or a cow away. Not at all. Unless Allah gives it to you, the giver of the life. So He says, yes, I will give it to you on condition that there is necessity to take the life away. And that you invoke my name, seek my permission when you are doing that. Otherwise, it will not be considered halal. You are stealing it from the property of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You cannot haphazardly kill. This is rahmah. The point I want to raise, if rahmah includes not killing animals, do you think Muslims are allowed to kill human beings? That's a question. Today, people are trying to tarnish the image of Islam by claiming that you're allowed to kill this one because you disagree with them, and that one because he's not a Muslim, and this one because he's a Muslim but he belongs to another sect, and that one because he's a Muslim but he has this issue and that issue. If Allah says you cannot kill the chicken we spoke about a few minutes ago, then don't you think common logic that the life of human being is absolutely sacred, subhanallah, you will not take it away? And those who do and claim that it's okay, they are tarnishing the image of Islam by involving in that which is totally un-Islamic. So much so that sometimes we believe they are planted by the enemies of Islam in order to destroy the image of rahmatun lil alameen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. My brothers, my sisters, the youth out there, never let someone brainwash you into believing that Islam is a religion of violence. Not at all. It is a religion of peace and more peace. Islam itself refers to submission and it refers to peace. Iman refers to belief in Allah and it refers to security, aman. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on us. The second word in Surah Al-Fatiha describing Allah is Ar-Rahim. I spoke about the first one known as Ar-Rahman. The second one is Ar-Rahim. So what is that all about? It is also derived from Rahmah, which means the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But at the same time, it is referring to a specialized mercy for those who believe in Allah.
وَكَانَ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَحِيمًا.
And indeed, Allah has a specialized mercy for those who believe. How do you achieve this? My brothers and sisters, when you believe in Allah, something happens to you. You are at peace. Why? Because you believe in Allah. Your iman is strong. You have boosted your iman. It is solid. The more strong your iman is, the more calm you are. Even though things will happen, not according to your plan or your liking, but according to the plan of Allah and His liking. I plan, for example, to achieve something, to get some profit in my business, and I don't achieve it. Do I need to become depressed? Allah says, part of the mercy of Allah upon you. All you need to do is have conviction and you will be okay. Tonight I want to take the liberty of some beautiful rahmah that perhaps many speakers do not speak about. When you and I arrive at the point of death, the only thing that will keep you going, and remember this, please, my brothers and sisters, is hope in the mercy of Allah. There is nothing else that you can have. The rest of the people are depressed. No matter how powerfully you clutch onto your bed, your soul will still depart the body. No matter how hard you try, no matter how much you are ready to pay, your soul will still depart the body. They will still bury your body. There is no chance, nothing else besides having hope in the mercy of Allah. Rahmatun lil alameen. If Allah says He is merciful on the dog and the pig, surely we are more honorable and honored than those. Allah will have mercy on you. You are definitely going to a better place. Do not doubt that at all. I feel sorry for those who don't believe in the hereafter, for those who don't believe that there is life after death, because they become depressed. For them, they cling on to dear life. Wallahi, I tell them today, if it was only about life, surely we would have been living longer than 70 years. The average lifespan is 70, 80, say for example, between 60, 70, so on. If it was only about life and to enjoy this life, firstly, we would be living longer lives. It's too short. Secondly, we would be able to enjoy what we want to enjoy, because that would be life. If Allah just created you, or if you just, for example, popped up like some people believe, you just came out by nature. I normally say we were not apes before. Maybe those who think they were apes might have been apes, but not us. But at the same time, if that was the case, where we just popped up from nowhere and suddenly we evolved and we die, do you really think we would not be able to achieve whatever we want to achieve? Why is that the case? Why is it that every single person, without one exception, without even a single exception, you can never ever have what you want on earth? You will get some and some you won't. A day for you and a day against you. That is the mercy of Allah. If all of us were given whatever we wished, perhaps we would be wishing the death of other people. And if we were granted that, we would all be dying one by one. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on us. So Allah says there is Rahim. Allah is merciful upon the believers. They feel that mercy. The more powerfully they believe, the more strong that belief is within them. You have people, mashallah, they have a small thorn that pricked them on their finger. They already start questioning Allah. Oh Allah, what did you do to me? Why me? Why did this happen? And you have people, they have lost lives and limbs, and still they say Alhamdulillah ala kulli hal. When the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he lost his son Ibrahim, he was holding him in his hands. And do you know what he said? He said, we will not utter a single word. We will not utter a single word against what Allah has decreed. Not one word. We will only say that which pleases Allah. Inna lillahi ma akhadha wa lahu ma a'ta. Indeed, Allah is the owner of everything He took away. And He was always the owner of everything He gave in the first place. When you have a son or a daughter, you are quick to think, that's my son, my daughter. We are quick to think that. Allah allows you to say that, but He wants you to know deep down it is His creature. That's what it is. When He takes the child away before you, He loved the child more than you could ever have loved the child. Remember this. This is the mercy of Allah. He is merciful. People say, if Allah was so merciful, why are children losing their lives? Perhaps He did not want them to grow up in an environment that would be merciless. So He took them away to a point of mercy. This is why when someone dies as a Muslim, what do we say? They have gone into the mercy of Allah. They have gone into the mercy of Allah. That's what we say, which means they are in a better place. Allah does not allow you to taste hurt beyond a certain point. He takes your life away. If someone starts slicing your body, may Allah not do that to us, and may that never happen to us. You will feel the pain initially, but beyond the point you will faint. And beyond that point you will die. Why? Because Allah is having mercy on you. He doesn't want you to taste so much of pain. Beyond a certain point He says, no, you're taken away. When a person suffers a car accident and they've broken bones, many a time you will find them unconscious. That's the gift of Allah. He doesn't want them to feel what's happening. Did you ever think of that? People say they're in a coma. That coma is a gift of Allah. Perhaps if they were alive, they would not be able to endure the pain. That's the mercy of Allah. Talk of rahmatun lil alameen. So this is ar-Rahim. But let's get back to the term. The title of the convention, Al-Islam Rahmatun Lil Alameen. Why is it that we hear Rahmatun Lil Alameen? And now that we know the term Rahmah, Al-Alameen refers to several things. If you look at the translation in the Quran, you will come to find that it says the worlds, plural of world. So a non-Muslim might say, well, I only believe in one world. I only believe in one world. So what would happen is, we would say, it refers to all the creatures of Allah. And it refers to all the time frames, the worlds, meaning starting from the very beginning, right up to the very end. That which we know, that which we will not know, that which we don't know, whatever Allah has decided to create, whatever He has. Do you not know that every day science is discovering new planets? They are claiming are hundreds of thousands and millions of times bigger than the earth. Recently they discovered so many planets, they say bigger than the biggest we ever knew about before this. So big that when they initially saw it, they didn't even know what it was. Discoveries. And this is why Allah says in the Quran, سَنُرِيهِمْ آيَاتِنَا فِي الْآفَاقِ وَفِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حتى يتبين لهم أنه الحق. We will continue showing them signs within themselves and in the horizons until it is proven to them beyond any doubt whatsoever that the Quran is the truth. Whatever the Quran has said is the truth. Science only has what we would term theories. It's a scientific theory. Theories keep changing. Did you know that? They will tell you today there is a theory or a discovery. Tomorrow they discover something and they will cancel the previous conclusion that they arrived at. They cancel it. But what the Quran has come with, not canceled. Not even one statement. Why? He created absolutely everything. He knows what is there. You cannot deny that. Go and test it. Don't look at the detractors who come and try and look for fault when there is no fault. Recently, I heard a clip of an Indian man trying to say that the Quran says Jesus is the Son of God. He doesn't even know the meaning of the term Ruh, and he doesn't even know the Arabic language, and he is pulling cotton wool over a lot of the Muslimin because we are ignorant regarding our own religion. That's the reason. We don't even know. The bulk of us here, I think, are Muslims. I would not be wrong if I were to tell you that you have not yet known the meaning of the Quran. Because I know that's a weakness of the majority of the Muslims. That's why people make a fool of us. We worship things we're not supposed to worship only because we have not yet read the Quran. We do things we're not supposed to do. We call them religion, yet we've made life difficult for us and our children when we've added things into the faith without knowing, claiming that we were born Muslim, we know better, not realizing that no, you are actually wrong, you haven't even read the Quran. This is why my experience, my personal experience, those who were not Muslim and reverted to Islam, they know the Quran better than a lot of those who were born Muslim because we took it for granted. It's a reality. You want to know about the mercy of Allah? Just open the pages of the Quran. You will see how beautiful Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is and how much mercy He has had. He does have. He will have. Like I said, at the point of death, my brothers and sisters, one thing you will need is the hope in the mercy of Allah. Don't ever think of your sins at the time of death. Think of the times you worshipped Allah. Look at the mercy of Allah. Have you heard of the story of the Prophet Moses, may peace be upon him, and the magicians? Yes, you have. What did the magicians do? They were brought by the Pharaoh and they were told to throw their ropes and sticks in order to combat the serpent that came through from the stick of Musa alayhi salam, Moses, may peace be upon him. So they did it. And Allah says that the snake from the stick of Musa alayhi salam swallowed up all that which was created or which was made by the magic of the others to seem like they were snakes that were moving. Everything swallowed. So these were top magicians when they saw that there is no sign of our ropes and sticks. They immediately fell prostrate. To whom? Now before I tell you to whom, let me quickly explain. You know, magic, sometimes what they do is, they convert things from one to another very quickly, so you cannot really see. Some of them are just conjurers. So fast, they take it out of the sleeve. You don't realize it's come out and you think, wow, you know. And they're just quicker than the eye, that's all. Quicker than your eye, you need to know this. And sometimes it's magic aided by the jinn. You know, the jinn are dangerous. In fact, just today I was telling some of the brothers a little joke on a lighter note. And I want to share it with you because it's very interesting. You know, we as Muslimin, we are supposed to say Bismillah. Bismillah means, what does it mean? In the name of Allah. You say Bismillah before you eat, for a reason. You say Bismillah before you drink, for a reason. You say Bismillah when you're doing anything, for a reason. So they told one young man, or one boy was telling another boy, say Bismillah. The man says, but I'm only drinking water. What did he say? Say Bismillah. He says, but I'm only drinking water. Now you and I know Bismillah means in the name of Allah. And even when you're drinking water, you're supposed to say Bismillah. So the young boy is trying to explain, why do I have to say Bismillah? So the one is telling the other, do you know why? Because there are three jinns. In water, there are three jinns. Three jinns in water. You need to say Bismillah. So the boy is frightened. Obviously, we all hear about it. Three jinns in water? Yes, two hydrogens and one oxygen. Mashallah. You know, water is H2O, mashallah. So you need to say Bismillah. Anyway, that was just a side swipe, as they call it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease. So getting back to the point of the jinn, they know that the bare minimum is there must be a sign left of what we brought. I brought my sticks and my ropes. Where is the sign? There is no sign. It's gone. It's gone into thin air. No sign. That is why they knew that this is not magic. This is a sign from Allah. They fell prostrate. And Pharaoh used to say he is God. So the fear was, if we say we are prostrating to God, they would think it's Pharaoh. And Pharaoh would say, yes, didn't I tell you? Ana rabbukumul a'la, I am the God, I am the highest. You know, at one stage he told his people, and this is how sad the world is. Sometimes we behave in such a way that even our common logic is defied, but we don't even think about it. So Pharaoh tells his people, he says, Allah says in the Quran, وَقَالَ فِرْعَوْنُ يَا أَيُّهَا الْمَلَأُ مَا عَلِمْتُ لَكُمْ مِنْ إِلَٰهٍ غَيْرِي Pharaoh told his chiefs, his cronies, and his people, "Oh, my people, I don't know of another God for you besides me." Imagine, he was a human being. He used to cough, he used to vomit, he used to go to the toilet, everything. And he's saying, "I'm a God." And they used to say, "Yes, yes, 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 you are the God, you are the God." Why? Wealth and power. That's what it was. Wealth and power. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease. So the magicians were fearful. They thought, if we say we have prostrated to God, perhaps people might think, "Yes, we knew you would turn back to the Pharaoh." So they said, and Allah mentions this in the Quran, beautifully put.
قالوا آمنا برب العالمين رب موسى وهارون.
We have indeed believed in the Lord of the worlds. Notice the worlds. The term is used again. Worlds. Why? It refers to all the times. The time of Adam, the time of Noah, the time of all the different messengers of Allah, the time of Abraham, the time of Jesus, the time of Moses, the time of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. All these are different people. Alameen includes that in its meaning. It also includes entire creation from the beginning right to the end. That's the mercy of Allah. So then they said, "We believe in the Lord of the worlds, the Lord of Musa and Harun, Moses and Aaron." That's the one. We just want to clarify, it's not Pharaoh. Whoever these two are worshipping, he is the correct God. Subhanallah. So this was the lesson that we learned. The Pharaoh learned. He knew, but he defied. The same applies to some of the people at the time of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They knew, but they defied. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "We will be merciful even upon those who are disbelievers." Do you want to hear the verse? This is obviously mercy referring to the fact that they too will earn, they will have children, they will have their fair share in this world. If they are good people, they will get goodness in this world in return. Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam makes a dua. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes it.
وَإِذْ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ رَبِّ اجْعَلْ هَذَا بَلَدًا آمِنًا وَارْزُقْ أَهْلَهُ مِنَ الثَّمَرَاتِ مَنْ آمَنَ مِنْهُمْ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ.
Surah Al-Baqarah. Allah says, remember when Abraham called out to his Lord and he said, "Oh my Lord, make this city of Mecca a safe city." MashaAllah, it's a very safe city. "And grant its inhabitants, those who believe from amongst them, sustenance." So Allah says,
قَالَ وَمَنْ كَفَرَ فَأُمَتِّعُهُ قَلِيلًا.
Even those who disbelieve, we will give them sustenance for a certain period of time. Subhanallah. If Allah wanted, He could have said, "Okay, those who disbelieve, from the point of disbelief, we punish them straight away." No. That is all connected to the hereafter. As for this world, you find sometimes the Muslimin might not be as wealthy as the non-Muslim. It happens. That's a test of Allah. The Muslimin may not have as many obedient children as the non-Muslim. It can happen. The Muslimin may struggle and suffer in terms of sickness, sometimes in a way that some of the weaker ones may become despondent. And you look at the non-Muslims enjoying good health and having beauty and whatever else on earth, enjoying luxury. Allah says, hang on. These are coupons that are spent. When you did good, you earned a coupon. The coupons of the believers are kept in store for them to be given in the hereafter. The coupons of the disbelievers are given to them here in the world. They are given it in a different way. They have good children, they have wealth and happiness and so many other points of joy. But Allah is not merciless. He is not oppressive. He is not unjust in any way. When you do good, you get good in return. The difference is some get it in the world and some get it in the hereafter and some get it in both. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on us. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy, I've only discussed one small aspect of it. But let me move into a whole huge aspect of it. And I'm sure that is what we were expecting when we came here this evening. One man, the best of creation, the most noble of all prophets, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. himself, he was sent as a mercy to Al-Alameen. He was sent as a point of mercy. Why? On one hand we say Al-Islam rahmatun lil-alameen. And the other hand we say Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam rahmatun lil-alameen. Islam is mercy to the world. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, mercy to the world. He is the one who brought Islam. Where did it come from? It came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if you look at Islam in the meaning of submission, it existed from the time of Adam. Because the duty from the beginning was to submit. Submit to what? To the law of your maker, in order that you may achieve happiness. You know, common logic is when you bake a cake and you want the cake. Say for example you love carrot cake, mashallah. Carrot cake is a lovely cake, I like it too, mashallah. Please don't make me carrot cakes and come deliver them. No, I won't eat them, mashallah. But I'm just saying, a carrot cake, a healthy cake, mashallah. You want it, mashallah. What do the sisters say when you have tasted a nice cake at your friend's house? What do you say? Can you give me the recipe, mashallah, isn't it? Can you give me the recipe? Why? I want to make a cake like this. And sometimes if we are wealthy enough, where did you buy it from? Wow, isn't it? Where did you buy it from? And they tell you there. And some of the sisters say, no, I don't give recipes away. Have you heard that? Yes. I will compile them in a book when I am 40 years old, and then I will sell them at 200 ringgit. You can buy it. Anyway, to cut a long story short, we get excited, we want, we achieve the ingredients and the method, and we are here making the cake. So you turn on the oven, you have the flour, you have the carrots, you grate them up, mashallah, you have the baking powder, you have the sugar, you have everything there, you learn how to mix it, and you know when to mix it, how much to mix, you have all these little measurements, so much of this, so much of sugar. If you say, nah man, I know better than all this, let me just look at my eye and I will decide how much to do, what will happen to the cake? It will flop. It's not going to be there. But if you follow exact instructions, what will happen? You submitted to the instruction. You achieved the cake. You submitted to the instruction from the one who knows about it. Sometimes you will go for baking lessons. Why? Because you want to submit. How many of us would go for a lesson and tell the teacher, you don't know what you're talking about? Well, why the hell did you come here? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. You wasted your time. It's okay, Shaykh. It's okay. I don't normally drink water during speeches. MashaAllah. So, MashaAllah. I thought this was one of the ingredients of the cake coming to me. Alhamdulillah. But mashallah, you achieved what you wanted because you listened. You actually heard. This is what happened. Now, the owner of peace is Allah. The owner of contentment is Allah. The owner of the hereafter is Allah. The owner of this world is Allah. The owner of everything you want is Allah. He has ingredients. Whenever did you go and learn about those ingredients? And when you've learned about them, why haven't we put them into practice by submitting? This is why we say you submit to the recipe of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to achieve contentment, happiness, success in this world and the next, you will achieve it. But you're not ready to submit to the recipe. You know why? We don't even know the recipe. The book is there, it's all over. It is free. People are distributing it. Non-Muslims are getting it and reading it more than you and I. This is why sometimes we don't have answers for basic questions that are asked. Yet we were born Muslim. And generations back we were always Muslim. Some people actually have beliefs that Muslims do this and do that, wrong things about Islam, and we don't clarify them. Because we haven't yet submitted, we don't even know. So Allah says, you want mercy? Well, here is the recipe, you will achieve it. And on top of that, He says, we will grant you from all, we will send you a messenger. Allah doesn't just leave you like that, He sends you a messenger. It was His duty. He wants you to do something. He sent you a messenger. Once Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was asked by one of his companions, O messenger, we have believed in you. We have fought with you in the sense that we have fought to protect Islam and the Muslimin and to protect ourselves. And we have done so much and we have sacrificed. Is there anyone, can there be anyone more beloved than us? to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So do you know what the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said? He said, yes, there will be people who will come later on who will believe in me without having seen me. They will be more beloved. My brothers and sisters, you and I today, absolutely convinced that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came. He said he was sent by Allah. He gave the message. The whole world changed completely. The biggest change ever. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was gone, but his sunnah remained with us. His teachings remained with us. So it is our duty to keep on going back and asking ourselves, did I add something? Did I subtract something? If I did, let me go back. Otherwise, what was the point? There is no gift. The ingredients, did I add something? Where am I going wrong? What did I do wrong? Today the Muslimin are struggling. We are looked down upon as the worst people on earth. Every Muslim, you have a name, Muhammad and Abdullah, they look at you and think you are a terrorist. Why? Because you are wearing your hijab. What happened? We are the people who are the owners of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He gave it to us. The problem is we've added and subtracted so much, either this extreme or the other extreme. Where are we with the middle path of Islam? Where are we with the love of Islam? Where are we with the love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught? When there were people who threw upon him dirt, there was an elderly lady who threw upon him dirt regularly. One day it didn't come in his direction. He went back to inquire. My dear mother, today I want to know what's wrong with you. Are you okay? What brings you here? What do you want to ask about? Well, every day when I pass here, then you throw something on me, right? Today it didn't come, so I thought maybe you're not well. I came to see, is there something I can do for you? Wow. With us, we start a war. First on WhatsApp, and then on Facebook, and then on Instagram, and then on Twitter, and then somewhere else. We're fighting, we're jealous, we want to show everyone everything, every little thing. There's a photo of it. So those who don't have, their hearts hurt. They become jealous of us. Why do you want to showcase everything? Yes, you may want to, perhaps one or two matters of goodness, if for some reason that has benefit in it, you might want to show things. But my brothers and sisters, I warn you, if you want rahmah and mercy of Allah, be considerate of those who don't have what you are showing them on Facebook and Twitter. A lot of the times, there are people who show things that they don't own. You know, they will go to a store, and they will try out this dress, take a photo. Try out another dress, take a photo. They didn't buy any dress, but they've got all those photos on Facebook and Twitter pretending like they owned it. That's all pretense. That's not Photoshop. That is actually literally going in and doing window shopping and pretending like it was you. You haven't bought anything. And then the poor salesmen and the saleswomen, they look at these people and they say, are you just doing this for Facebook? Yes, it has happened. They look at you and they ask, are you doing that? Are you really a buyer or are you just wasting my time? So much so that I've come across a website that tells you you can go on holiday anywhere in the world without actually going there. How? We can take photos of you in France and here and there and Photoshop them and you can pretend to your friends. Why? It's become a fake life. You show people what you really are not. That's what it is. It's fake. What type of mercy will you have when you are merciless regarding the others? Why show? Why make people's hearts hurt? Is that what a Muslim is all about? Is that what Islam is? Subhanallah. No, it's not. Go back to the teachings of Islam. Lead a simple life. Be happy with the small things. Reach out to others. You want the mercy of Allah? Have mercy on others whom Allah has created. Irhamu man fil ardi, yarhamkum man fis sama. Be merciful upon those on earth. The one in the heavens will have mercy on you. That is what the hadith says. مَنْ لَا يَرْحَمْ لَا يُرْحَمْ. Whoever does not have mercy will not be shown mercy either. So you want to achieve the mercy of Allah. All you need to do is have mercy on others as well. Be merciful. Be kind. Don't be stingy, selfish, niggardly. Think about yourself. Alone. No, think about others. Be considerate. When you eat out every day because your husband can afford it, the others cannot afford. They cannot afford to eat out every day. So what would happen? Perhaps they might see you with all your food every day. Then you are complaining, my stomach is aching. And people are wishing for what's inside there. You don't even know, you were showing them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease. So rahmatun lil alameen. He went to this lady. As a result, she declared her faith to say, you are indeed a messenger. You know, what makes me so happy when I see the non-Muslim historians write about Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and when they write accurately saying he was the man who achieved the most ever in the smallest period of time. Think about it. He has 2 billion or more followers today. Yet he lived in an era where, forget about Facebook and Twitter and internet and communication, there was no even loud hailer, no microphone, no telephone, no fax, no telex. Subhanallah. What happened? The whole world changed. That cannot just be an ordinary man. History recorded by non-Muslims will confirm that he was an individual whom the most change ever has happened on the globe as a result of him being sent. Do you know why? I will tell you why. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. We have not sent you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, except as a mercy for the worlds. Look at the regulations and the rules governing the way we live. When Allah tells you to cover my beloved sisters, when Allah tells you to cover my beloved brothers, it is in order to keep you happy and content. If the women are uncovered, you have men not appreciating what they have, but they appreciate what is not theirs and what they will never have. And they die a depressed life thinking, I never got what I wanted in my life. But if you are covered, mashallah, you are dressed appropriately, your beauty is specialized for certain people, the contentment you have in your home, when your husband appreciates you, when he loves you, when he thinks about you, and vice versa. And you realize the value. Why? Because you don't just go out. Allah says, lower your gaze. Why? We want you to appreciate what you have. We want mercy in the home. So lower your gaze. You're going to come home and hurt all the hearts to say, look at this hair of yours. Today when I was in the mall, I saw one lady with the hair flying all over. I wish yours was like that. Listen, mine is not going to be like that. I'm losing hair because you're stressing me. Simple as that. Maybe if you stop stressing me, I might have flying hair. Allahu Akbar. Subhanallah. Yes, people make these comments. What happens? The mercy is gone from your home. No more mercy. Why? Your statements are merciless. You come home and say, but you're looking fat la. You heard that one? MashaAllah. You're looking fat. So, you're the one who impregnated me already 5 times. And now you're telling me look fat? You can marry a model. She will expect twice or thrice. You don't expect her body to remain the same. Subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease. Be merciful with your statements. Go and utter words of love to those whom you are supposed to be uttering them to. That is what mercy is. The problem with us, we are full of love. The men are very romantic. But with the wrong people, Allahu Akbar. You go into your office and, oh, you're looking pretty. When last did you tell that to your wife? Subhanallah. Your problem would have been resolved. Subhanallah. Even if you were telling a lie. That is mercy. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. May Allah have mercy on us. The problem with us, wallahi, we lead a depressed life because we haven't followed the ingredients of leading a beautiful life. We haven't. Say good words. Do you know, if the hadith says tabassumuka fi wajhi akhika sadaqa, to smile at the face of your fellow Muslim or your brother is a charity, it's a rewarded act. What about smiling at the face of your spouse, your children, your parents, your brothers and sisters, those who work for you? Smile at them. Just smile. That's all. Break into it and see. You walk in, at least acknowledge them. Today we don't even greet. I know of people whom I have greeted them and they have not greeted back because they felt that they were someone and we were nothing. Wallahi. Don't ever do that. One of your tests is to greet back. Someone greets you, greet back. Look at them with a smile. That person might be the reason you enter Jannah. can be. That person might be the reason you enter paradise. They might pray for you because they've never seen someone so humble as you. They might be something that you have moved in their lives just by looking at them and smiling and saying, wa alaykum as-salam, and walk away. Or something small, something minor. Your interactions need to be great. This is what we were taught. By whom? Rahmatun lil alamin. The one sent to us to achieve the peace that we are searching for. Today the whole world is looking for what? For contentment. The whole world is searching for contentment. You will not find contentment in the nightclubs. You will not find it in the rock stars. You will not find it in the pop stars. They are called pop stars because they are blown up and suddenly they pop. All their lives, a lot of the pop stars commit suicide. They are on drugs. They lead a depressed life. Look at the movie stars. A lot of them, not all of them, but a lot of them. They lead lives in reality that are totally full of depression. But look at the Muslimin. You see a mu'min in his or her face. You can see calmness. You can see coolness. You might not know how they are suffering. They may have greater suffering than you've ever imagined. But they are happy. They are smiling. Why? It's rahmatun lil alameen. Allah has taught you how to go through it. He didn't say, I'm going to cancel your taqdeer. No. I'm going to cancel your predestiny. No. He said, I will help you go through it. This path you're going to be walking on. I chose your questions, your tests, your difficulties, calamities, your points of ease, all as a test, because life is a test. But at the same time, if you believe in me, I will help you go through it. I will make sure I hold your hand as you walk through the big knocks that you will be taking on your path, and you will be a happy person until you reach the point of death with a smile. Have you heard the poem of the poet? In the Arabic language, there is a little couplet. I say it in the English language because the translation is also quite powerful. You were given birth to, O son of Adam. You came to this earth while crying, and those around you were smiling in happiness, right? You were crying when you came onto the earth. You cried. If you didn't cry, what did they do? They spanked you on your bottom a little bit to make you immediately, isn't it? Yes, you had to, for your lungs and for all other purposes. You came to this world and you were crying, and all those around you were smiling in happiness. So live your life in such a way that the day you leave, you will leave with a smile, and those around you will be crying at the loss. Wow, subhanallah. The problem with us, we live a life such that while we are alive and fit, people are saying, oh Allah, take him away. He's such a stress. Just take him away. And then when someone says he died, instead of saying, inna lillahi, mashallah, mashallah. So may Allah not do that to us. Why? Why do we need to live our lives in such a way that we are looked at as a problem, as a difficulty, an issue? Lead a good life. Be a person filled with mercy. Take a look at Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Even in battle, when they were fighting legitimate wars in order to achieve what they had lost at the hands of the kuffar of Mecca. Remember, they were driven out of Mecca. They were driven out of their homes. They were their homes and their wealth were usurped, taken away. So they had to come back to regain it. And they had to defend themselves wherever they were attacked and so on. Even in that instance, the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, sent as a mercy. He used to say, do not harm those who do not harm you. Do not fight those who put the weapons down. Do not harm a female. Do not harm the children. Do not harm the elderly. Do not harm the priests and the rabbis who are in their monasteries and so on. Do not harm those who go into their houses and close their doors. What are we doing today? Where are we? Where is the Islamic teaching? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us and guide us. Islam is not a franchise. It's not patented to you. No. It belongs to people who may not be Muslim today, who might enter Islam after your death, and they might go to paradise before you could ever get there. That's what Islam is. It's not patented to anyone. It's not the copyright of someone. So be careful. Treat people with respect. Let's continue. See the mercy of Islam. What did Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught? What did he teach? Sometimes He has shown us such a great example that it's difficult for us to adopt it, but we are inspired by it. Let me give you an example. He entered Makkah al-Mukarramah victorious, known as Fath Makkah, the victory of Makkah. So many thousands of Sahaba radiallahu anhum, companions, were with him. And he entered Makkah where the enemy was. Those who harmed them, those who killed their family members and stole their wealth, those who intended to kill him as well. And when he went in, he asked them one question. They knew this man has come to us today with so much of power. He can do whatever he wants to us. He did not tell them, right, I'm putting all of you into orange uniforms and you're going to be in a box here for 20 years when we're not worried about you. 15 years later, we will release you while you are sick and ill and half of you will die in this little box in an orange uniform. He didn't do that. That's merciless. Total merciless. Islam is different. He looks at them and he says, Ya ma'shara Quraysh, O you enemies, combatants of war who wanted to kill us, destroy us, you wanted to harm us. You have already taken our wealth, our property. You've killed so many of our relatives. What do you think I'm going to do to you today? Wow, what a question. He's asking them, showing rahmatun lil alamin, the mercy to the worlds. Ya ma'shara Quraysh, ماذا تظنون أني فاعل بكم? What really do you think I'm going to do to you today? What answer do they have? Quiet. They cannot really answer. They hope goodness. We hope that it will be something decent, something good, you know. You're a good man. Now you're a good man. Why? Because you're in power. Subhanallah. When you were not in power, you were a bad man. Now you're suddenly a good man. You see. So he says, I will tell you what the Prophet Joseph, may peace be upon him, told his brothers. اذهبوا فأنتم الطلقاء. Go. Today you are free. You are completely released. No blame on you. There will be no retribution today. They were shocked. Shocked. Literally shocked. My brothers and sisters, let's face facts. Many of us cannot forgive our own brothers and sisters born out of one mother and one father. Do you agree? Many of us cannot forgive our family members, our children, our daughters, our sons, our brothers and sisters married into families or from one same family. And then we want to say, I'm Muslim, alhamdulillah, I'm Muslim. Hey, what Muslim? Muslim means I submitted. You have not yet submitted. You are just Muslim because your name is something Islamic. That's why the one of the narrations says, there will come a time, لا يبقى من الإسلام إلا اسمه ولا من القرآن إلا رسمه. There will come a time when nothing will remain about Islam except the name. And nothing will remain about the Quran except the writing. People know, well, Quran, yes, Quran. Put it on your head, put it on your head. And we walk up, put it high. Okay, high. Is that what the Quran is all about? Put it on your head, put it high. You need to read it, open it. It's a book. أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ Allah says, will they not ponder deeply over the verses of the Quran? They want to achieve rahmah. Look at what Allah says. وَإِذَا قُرِئَ الْقُرْآنُ فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ وَأَنصِتُوا لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ When the Quran is being read, it has such a power. Allah says, keep quiet, listen attentively, concentrate, so that you may achieve mercy. Mercy, rahmah. لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ You want mercy? Quran, listen, concentrate. Ponder over its meaning. Go back. Look into it. Try to practice it. You will achieve the mercy of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Kitabun. This verse is in Surah Sad. Kitabun anzalnahu ilayka mubarakun liyadabbaru ayatih. Waliyatadakkara ulul albab. A book that we have revealed to you, referring to the Quran, in order that you may ponder deeply over its verses. That's why Allah revealed the Quran. He is answering, if you were to ask Allah, why did you reveal the Quran? So this verse answers it. I revealed it in order that you ponder over it deeply so that it can be a reminder for those with intellect. If you are sharp, you are clever, you will see, I was born, I'm on earth. things don't seem to be happening the way I want them to happen all the time. And then I grow old, I see so many people are dying. Where did they go? How did they go? We are so intelligent. You know, think about it for a minute. We are so intelligent. We are so sharp. We have eyes. We have nose. We can see. We can feel. Do you think when you die, you're suddenly gone into thin air, nowhere? You go somewhere. We are too complicated not to be going somewhere. The creation of man. We are too sophisticated to just end there. Do you understand my point? We are too sophisticated to end at 80 years and gone. That's it. What happened to him? Oh, he became dust. I remember I was sitting with someone. One day we were walking past a house. There was a dead person there. You might have heard this in one of my previous lectures. And there was a dove or two at the top of the roof. So the two ladies walking, they say, oh, that's him. That's him. That's who? Oh, the person who died. Look, they became a dove. They became a dove. These doves were doves before he died, right? Allahu Akbar, a dove. These doves were doves before he died. We are too complex and complicated to become doves and snakes. Now, with all due respect to those who believe that. But at the same time, we believe we are going into the mercy of Allah. We're going to the best place. Allah kept this world in such a way that you do not get everything you want, because in the hereafter, He will give you absolutely everything you want. This was the test. It's part of the mercy of Allah. So there is Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam forgiving. You want to taste mercy? Learn to forgive. Don't hold things on your shoulders. When you hold them, you are the one who cracks down. You are the one who starts hunching because of what you've got. You're holding hatred and jealousy and envy and enmity on your shoulders. Release it. Take it out. Let it go. Let it go now. You feel good. You be the person who started to resolve the matter. You phone, you make the phone call. Listen, sorry, forgiven, forgotten. I'm sorry if I've done something wrong, and that's it. If they don't want to have a more deeper relationship with you, or you don't want to have a deeper relationship, no problem. But at least you're not holding it on your shoulders. Release it. Why? You will lead a happy life. You are a believer. Look at Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If he wanted, he could have kept it and said, right, you guys, everyone here, like I said, we're going to punish you. He didn't do that. I can give you another example. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Taif. What happened? Wallahi, he was chased by the children of Taif, and they were throwing stones at him. And the most blessed blood in existence was made to spill, to drip. It was dripping into his shoes. And the angels came to him and told him, we are sent by Allah. We are the angels who are in charge of these mountains. You give us one instruction and we will destroy these people because of what they did to you. Do you know what he says? I have been sent as a mercy. If they don't believe, oh Allah, at least let their children see the light. He knew. He knew that he was the messenger of Allah. So what did he do? It was simple for him to say, break them and walk away. I think a lot of us would probably have done that. And a lot of us right now, we have such enemies in our lives that we would hope the angel comes to us and says, I can destroy them. I can break them. Just let me know. Say, yeah, come on, go for it, go for it. Don't tell anyone I said break them, but break them. That's how we are. But learn to forgive and release. You will see them in goodness. Learn to reach out to people. Go and feed the others. Take a look at the refugee crisis that is occurring across the globe. Thank Allah it hasn't happened to us. Thank Allah. And reach out to them somehow. If you cannot reach monetarily or physically, at least pray for them. Thank Allah. Pray for them. Oh Allah, there are people who are closer to you than I am. And you have made them go through tests that are more difficult than mine. And here, have mercy on them, Ya Allah. It's the mercy of Allah. Sometimes when Allah keeps you poor, it's because of His mercy. When He knows that if we were to give you wealth, you would go away from Him. That brings me to a very interesting point. People have sickness. Once I met a young man who told me, I'm becoming a Christian. Why? Because I'm so sick. I've been calling out to Allah for so long and He's not curing me. So I decided, let me try out Christianity because Jesus is full of love. So I told him, if Jesus is full of love, the one who made Jesus is even more full of love. You need to know that. And I told him something that made him change his mind once again. What was it? I said, I just want you to consider the fact that there are people who are Christian who have bigger diseases than yours. That's all you need to know. So it's got nothing to do with what faith you're following. It's got to do with the test chosen for you, no matter what faith you're following. Don't lose faith. Don't lose hope. You want to call out to Jesus because you're saying that you're not being cured by calling out to Allah. There are Christians who have been calling out to Jesus all their lives and they have not been answered. Does that mean they must all become Muslimin? So hang on, don't lose your faith. He says, wow, I didn't look at it that way. This is why we say talk, speak, say things. Then I said, listen, my brother, you called out to Allah for how long? He says, for very long. I said, okay. Before that, he said, before that, I didn't even used to pray. Okay. Allah has so much mercy on you that He kept you in a certain condition so that your heart is soft and you keep on praying to Him. You understood that? If Allah cures you today, what will happen? You might forget and you might go back to your bad ways and habits and you might stop praying once again. Why? I prayed and prayed to Allah. He answered my call, so I stopped praying now. So Allah says, as a mercy to you, we kept you sick and ill so that you could keep on praying with a soft heart until you met us and we gave you paradise because you had a soft heart. You died praying to us. That was mercy. We look at death as something depressing, yet we don't realize for a true believer, it is a means of getting back to his maker. Your examination is over. You now go back to your maker with a smile. You don't need to be depressed about it. This is faith. This is conviction. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on us. So if you look at the life of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, may peace be upon him, you will find indeed that there are so many shining examples of his treatment of the women, his treatment of the elderly, his treatment of the enemies, how he lived himself. How he looked at matters that affected him and the ummah. How he was concerned about the widows and the orphans. How he was concerned about the less privileged. How he was concerned about those who had physical disability. How he was concerned about the elderly and so on. All that points to the mercy that Allah sent him with. Let us learn from this. An hour's talk will not do justice to the topic, but we have a 3-day convention, and I'm sure so many other speakers will be tackling topics connected to the same theme. And I hope we will be able to achieve as much as possible. I thank you for your patience, and I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us all mercy. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi, subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdik. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.